We're finally here. It's been a long journey, but we are finally here. We've gone from this slightly monolithic big PCB to this more modular version that will allow me to chain multiple digits together without having a massive and expensive PCB. There are still a few things that I think could be improved, but it is pretty functional for now. As always, the boards came from PCB Way, fantastic service. I've based the design around the TPIC6595 power shift registers. These have open drain outputs that can sink a large amount of current, so they are ideal for this kind of application. In my original design, apart from some decoupling capacitors and indicator LEDs, I was mostly using through-hole components. This new modular version is different. I've switched over to using SMD components for everything, apart from the sockets and screw terminals. If you've been following along with the previous videos, then you will have already seen the slightly silly mistake I made. When I was ordering the parts, I made a slight snafu and ended up with a bunch of TPICA6595 ICs. Now, you wouldn't think a single letter would make such a big difference, but the pinouts are completely different, and these ICs don't fit on the new PCB design. It turned out that it was actually pretty difficult to find any TPIC6595 in SMD format, so I bit the bullet and I redesigned my PCBs to fit the new part. I've linked to a video in the description where I run through this mistake and how I fixed it. It's definitely worth a watch. You can learn from my mistakes so you don't repeat them. Switching to the A variant of the component has had a benefit. I can now sink a lot more current. This means the LED filaments are much brighter. These power shift registers are pretty impressive and I can see a lot of fun applications for them. To support the high current, I've swapped the resistors I was using from a 15 ohm to a 10 ohm. With a 5 volt supply and about 3 volts dropping across the LED filament, we'll get a current of around 200 milliamps. The resistors I'm using are rated at 0.5 watts. With 2 volts at 200 milliamps, we get 0.4 watts, so that should be just about okay. I do think for the next revision of the board, I'll move up to the next resistor size to give ourselves a bit more leeway and maybe even go a bit brighter. There is another impact of this change. Now, with all the filaments lit, we will be drawing about 1.4 amps for each digit. If we include the optional decimal place, then we go up to 1.6 amps. Chaining together 4 digits to make a clock will mean a total of 6.4 amps. We are starting to get a little bit toasty. I'm thinking eventually of having 10 digits with decimal points. This will require a peak of 16 amps if everything is lit up at the same time. That's definitely more than a G-point connector can actually handle. They max out at around 2.5 amps. This is why in my design I opted for screw terminals for the 5 volt supply connections on each module. The screw terminals I'm using are only rated for 10 amps, but it will be quite easy to inject power at both ends of the display, so in theory we'll only have half the maximum current going through each terminal. We can also inject power in the middle of the chain of displays, so we've got a lot of flexibility in this area. On the PCBs themselves, I've put very thick traces from the power input terminal to the power output terminal. I've put these thick traces on both sides of the board, so in total we have a thickness of 10 millimeters. Using this handy trace width calculator, we can see that for our 50 millimeter length track with 16 amps, 10 millimeters should be okay, as our two tracks are both on the external layers. To chain the logic signals from board to board, I'm using standard 2.54 mm pitch PCB headers. Now, I was going to do a lot of crimping and make these connectors up with individual wires, but that is a lot of work and it would get really untidy very quickly. However, when I was laying out the PCBs, I was very careful to make sure that the signals all lined up and none of the connections would need to be crossed over. This means that I can use IDC ribbon cable to connect the signals together. You can buy these cables in wide strips that can be split down to the required size quite easily. The wires of these cables can all be connected at the same time using these connectors that pierce the insulation. So I bought one of these tools and I tried it out. It works really well. I was a bit worried that I would mess it up completely, but I did do a few tests and I didn't, so that's brilliant. The other main change from the original large PCB is that I've completely removed the level shifters from 3.3 volts to 5 volts, and I'm running the shift registers at 3.3 volts. When I did the original board, I followed the datasheet, which said that the chips required at least 4.5 volts and needed a high logic level of 0.85 that. This would have been 3.8 volts, which would not have worked directly from our 3.3 volt logic. However, I came across this technical note that said that the ICs will operate down to 3 volts. This means that we can power them from the 3.3 volt supply and it will work without needing any level shifting. I was slightly worried that this wouldn't work, but I realised that in the worst case scenario, I could just have one level shifter at the start of the chain and everything would still work nicely. Fortunately, my experiment showed that it would just work, which is great. We don't need any extra components to drive the boards. Assembly is pretty straightforward. I'm still working on my vacuum stencil holder. It's not working as well as I'd like it to, so I need to do some refinement to it. But it's easy enough with a stencil mask to apply the solder paste. Looking under the microscope, it's not too bad. Definitely still needs some improvement, but it will do. I'm also still using the MHP30 mini hot plate. This is working really well, but it is a bit small, which does mean we need to do a bit of manoeuvring to get everything melted. But the results are really great, and after a bit of cleaning with a soft brush and alcohol, we have some nice solder joints, and I don't see any bridging or bad connections. With all the boards SMD assembled, we just need to solder on the headers and screw terminals. And there we have it, a fully assembled 4-digit, 7-segment display. I've got more digit PCBs on order from PCBWay, as I really want to push the boundaries of how many segments I can drive. Anyone fancy a 10-digit jumbo size calculator? If you want to learn a bit more about how the software works, then you should definitely watch this video about NTP servers and time. It's pretty interesting.